For over three decades, the city of Detroit was dominated by the sounds of Motown soul artists. But like so many black music forms, Motown became a victim of its own success. And what began as an entirely black-owned label was eventually taken over by a mainstream corporation.
Whites have never been threatened by us entertaining them. A lot of soul music was sold to whites. Whites loved Motown. The question is, when you come off the stage, can you sit in the front office and control the business? We control less of the music business as blacks today than we did 40 years ago. That's the danger.
As hip-hop becomes a global industry, its original cultural ownership is increasingly under threat from commercial pressures.
We don't have the power to be contenders. We can run our small labels, but on a major level, when you're talking about the hundreds and hundreds of millions and millions of dollars that they generate, no, not yet.
African Americans have learned to be wary of what happens when the music they originate becomes the cultural property of mainstream America.
America, like I said, which is as black and white as a TV set, black folks have always shown that, hey, you know, respect us and let us be part of the family, because when the shoe's on the other foot, you know, we can prove that when we're going to be un-American, we're going to actually open the doors so we can share this thing.
Despite its ability to appeal to black and white America, hip-hop has sometimes been a racial battleground.
Cultural exchange is what rap music and hip-hop has been about across the planet. And so therefore, everybody has pretty much, if you want to just leave it to the pure essence of themselves, you allow hip-hop and rap music to go on its own, and it automatically it opens up the doors of communication between two sort of different-looking types of human beings and allows them to have that common language.
It's more than just music. It's the way you live, it's the way you breathe, it's the way you walk, it's what you wear. And that's why we as hip-hop junkies, or whatever you want to call it, live in our own little world and accept each other. You know, and a lot of that is based on because we all grew up the same.
But while hip-hop has been happy to welcome a white audience, it's been slower to embrace white rappers.
He had to prove to the hip-hop world that he was for real. So we would go to these little clubs, whether most of them being in Detroit, where there would be 20 people, 30 people, and he would go up on stage and he would battle one at a time.
Wasn't you the same nigga crying outside, crying outside, crying outside?
Back in the mid-1990s, it was almost unthinkable for a white rapper to enter Detroit's most infamous hip-hop hangout.
This is a hip-hop side. Yeah.
A lot of memories, man.
The hip-hop shop on 7 Mile was the heart of the city's underground scene. Here, rappers would regularly test their mic skills against one another at freestyle battles.
I used to come out here to battle, man. I used to get straight off work, come through, just crush somebody if I could. For real.
The Cardi Boys were among the elite of the Detroit underground when MC battles were a way of life for any aspiring rapper.
Battling is taking somebody's soul from them. Right. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Battling is like taking somebody's name
it
from them. Like
deep.
It's worse. It's worse than really somebody rolling up on you with an AK and shooting your ass up. You get the scar. The scar would be so deep. Duh. I don't think snitches can fix it.
This is the young Eminem performing at the Hip Hop Shop on 7 Mile in the mid 1990s. As this footage shows, it was a predominantly black environment, one that offered an intimidating but necessary arena for him to enter if he was to prove himself as a rapper.
Any rapper saying those kind of rhymes in this day and age, in this period of time, trying to battle Eminem is worse than David Starr trying to battle Proof IQ, B-flat, and Bizarre.
It was the MC skills he displayed here that, against the odds, earned him the respect of his Detroit peers.
Come on, man. Like, this is the most segregated place in the world. He had a lot of balls
just for coming in the hood.
He spoke with clarity. You know, he was right direct. He was on time. He followed his groove.
His pattern was nice. The way that he rolled the beats was nice.
Oh, he's sweet. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, yeah, you can't judge a book by its cover.
Soon, the color of his skin, once seen as an obstacle, became the thing Detroit's black hip-hop fans celebrated the most.
Black kids weren't really gonna listen to him talk too tough. He could come into those battles, and if he came in there talking about his 45 and his gun, the black kids weren't gonna allow that. They were gonna be like, I don't give a fuck, you're a white kid, and we're not hearing that. Eminem's not 6'5", 250 pounds, full of muscles. He's a small white kid, right? So he's so genius that instead of saying how tough he was, he humiliated himself. How can you get mad at somebody that disses himself?
'Cause ain't no such things as halfway crooks.
In his semi-biographical film, 8 Mile, Eminem showed that to win credibility as a rapper, he had to confront his skin color face on.
Fuck a papa doc, fuck a clock, fuck a trailer, fuck everybody. Fuck y'all if you doubt me. I'm a piece of fucking white trash, I say it proudly. And fuck this battle, I don't wanna win, I'm outie. Here, tell these people something they don't know about me.
We're at the Shelter in Detroit, Michigan. I've been coming to this place for 10, 11 years of my life. This is where a lot of the movie 8 Mile was based, a lot of the battle scenes and whatnot, down in the basement that you've seen in the movie. And this is basically where everybody comes, big stars, whether you're a little cat or a big, huge star, you still roll up in St. Andrews in the Shelter. So we're gonna go in here tonight, see some battles, listen to some music, drink some beer and shit, so it should be hot.
Shelter in downtown Detroit has become the symbol for the city's hip-hop explosion.
The crowd that we have on this particular night, it's like a lower middle class, largely from Detroit City. It's got to be 99% black.
Let's go, house show. Get this shit out. It's a fucking battle. Let's do it.
Check it out. I guess this dude think he hard-boiled. It ain't my fault that he looks like a gargoyle. Like school, I've been giving detention. What the fuck is this, y'all, a midget convention?
Two of the guys that we have in Detroit, in fact, Marv One and Swan, I would say are two of the best battle rappers in the country.
He a hoe for real. His name is Swan and he about to get killed. His name is Swan and he's soft like a girl. And Super MC, bitch, I rule the world.
Not all battle rappers can write rhymes and get in the studio and make it happen on record. The opposite is true too. A lot of great artists can't hold their own in a battle.
Check this out.
It's an art into itself.
I just heard what you spit. I mean every word. And that had to be the wackest shit I ever heard. Come on, man. Whose ass you gonna kick? You a midget. Your feet can't even reach my dick. Listen up, dog. You know you ain't the one. I feel bad. I gotta sit and murder my son. And he thinking that he hot like he a boss. When his chain's so goddamn thin that he could use it to floss.
Making it as a rapper, whether white or black, depends on building up a fan base from the streets. To help Paradigm get more exposure, his manager has enlisted the help of Tim Brack, a British promoter who, among others, has managed the career of one of Detroit's biggest acts, Kid Rock.
Freddie gave me his record. I drove off with it one day after the show, Kid Rock show. Thinking, okay, yeah, he's a cool guy, I like him, I know that Bob's up. Kid Rock's offered him a lot of things down the road. I had the record, I'm like, holy shit, man, this is a great record. I haven't had anything this exciting.
He actually called me and said, this is a great record.
It's fucking brilliant.
Fucking great record.
Dirty Girls
is a great record, he said.
It's not a Britney Spears, it's gonna happen overnight, but it's something that'll develop.
Yes, I am!
Well, you could be if you put that shirt skirt on.
Freddie's gonna do fine.
No, it's something that's gonna develop.
As long as she can handle it properly, I don't give a fuck who it is, whatever. I just want to make this shit.
The shit's gonna happen. This guy's like as good as Kid Rock, if not better, down the road. Could maybe even go further. The problem right now is not people have heard it. It's a Detroit-based thing that's stuck in Detroit, and once it breaks out of that, I think it's gonna blow up. I really believe it. Big time.
Like Eminem, Paradigm is ambitious and hungry for success. But as the Bass Brothers know only too well, he still has a long road ahead of him.
Marshall kind of gave up between 95 and 96 and a half, let's say, because it just wasn't happening for us. He came back, I remember he knocked on the door at the studio, and he walked in and he had a small tattoo on his arm that said Shady. And I said, what is Shady? And what it was his alter ego. And it was the raw side of Eminem. It was the gut-wrenching. It was all the feelings that were built up inside of him. And he came back with some material that was just incredible. It was this hard-hitting, raw hip-hop. Lose yourself in the music, the moment you own it, you better never let it go. You only get one shot, do not miss your chance to blow. This opportunity comes once in a lifetime. You're ready. With his growing reputation as a battle MC, Eminem began to attract the attention of some of the industry's most powerful entrepreneurs.
It's like he says, it lose yourself, you get that one opportunity.
One chance.
You get one opportunity, one chance, you better take it.
So what you gonna do, Drake? Kick it and so on, let the shit flow on, because I need some.
In 1997, while trying to get Eminem into some of the clubs in LA, Mark Bass was called into a meeting at Interscope Records with the label's boss, Jimmy Iovine, and one of Eminem's childhood heroes, Dr. Dre.
A lot of guys went into the offices of Jimmy Iovine, right? And not just Jimmy, other labels, and they, you know, yeah, I got this CD, you know, and they look at it and go, hey, that sounds pretty good. We're gonna give you a record deal. Here's 20 grand. Okay, you deliver us a record. So our situation, we had no money. And so we knew that existed.
I'll tell you.
And I'm not gonna mention names, but they tried to do that to us. And he, in the middle of the meeting, he takes the check, pulls his pants down, and wipes his ass with it. And he goes, we don't need the money. This is not what
it was.
We're
a
here
Sunday.
For.
It was
we
a
want,
Sunday.
We want your group, which was the Universal Group, let's say. You know, that's the team that we wanted to be with Marshall.
There was no one getting signed who was white in New York. It was just the bottom line. You know, it wasn't happening. And it needed, and it took, you know, Dre, and it really took Dre to kind of co-sign and say, yo, this kid is dope.
When we came to LA, they didn't know what the hell was going on. Two little white Jewish boys from Detroit coming into L.A. with gangster mentalities that don't have shit to stand on came to bust open at Los Angeles, you know?
Shit.
We busted everything. It's good.
Hi, my name is Mike. I mean, the whole idea of him as a pop culture icon started with Hi, My Name Is. And then it just worked from there. My name is Well, since age
12, I felt like a caged elf who stayed to himself in one space chasing his tail. Eminem may not have looked like the majority of rappers, but his experiences struck a chord with both black and white audiences.
He says something that touches a nerve. It's not about him being white so much. His experience is different, but really the projects in the trailer parks are very much alike.
He takes down the color barrier. You know, if you never showed Eminem's face, never showed his face, you couldn't tell that he was white. You'd just be like, wow, he going through a lot. So am I, you know. I could just imagine it.
You know, we knew somebody was gonna be at the top of the game, but like I said, we didn't know it was gonna stretch out where you got all over the world people trying to be like a Detroit cat and I wonder what we doing in Detroit, and you know.
I did not know that I would grow to be my mother's.
But will Eminem's mass appeal open a door to other white rappers eager to jump into the hip-hop game?
Well, Eminem is considered an artist, and others are considered rappers or thugs. So even though he may get vile, he never stops being an artist. There's almost a respect for Eminem that you don't see for black counterparts. And it's almost like Elvis and Chuck Berry. They both wiggling, but one became a king, and the other just became a rock and roller.
Listen up. I don't give a fuck if you're back there playing fucking pocket pool with your fucking balls. Get it up. We want some rock star shit. Take that shit. Break that shit. Money in the goddamn rock star shit.
Today, white consumers hold the power in America's hip-hop industry. By building up a large local following of white fans, Paradigm is tapping into hip-hop's biggest market. Is rap destined to follow rock and roll's path and be transformed into a music culture dominated by white faces?
Man, I'm fucking smashed. Yeah.